हेलो, आई एम मंजू शर्मा एंड टुडेज इज अ प्लंज इनटू द 14th सेंचुरी इंग्लैंड एज प्रेजेंटेड बाय द ग्रेट मास्टर ऑफ पोएट्री जेफरी चौसर. हिज आउटस्टैंडिंग वर्क दैट हैज कम ओवर to the world of literature is the prologue to Canterbury Tales. And today we are going to make an understanding of this book, this poem, and we'll see the world, if not England, through the eyes of this poet, Geoffrey Chaucer. But while in the course of the study of this book, we will see that it is just not the portrayal of one part of the globe, but it is the portrayal of the whole world. So let us, right from the title, pick up the operative words and see what do they mean and how do they contribute to this beautiful legend that is the prologue. Now, what is a prologue? Prologue is the word that is said before moving into the major work. The word said before actually speaking the tales. So this is the prologue, the introduction that will bring you, that will launch you to see the pilgrims telling their tales while on their way to Canterbury. What then is Canterbury? Canterbury is the shrine of the Saint Thomas Becket, who was a martyr whose help was sought when people were sick. Now we see that the 30 pilgrims that are moving towards the shrine of St. Thomas Becket, in fact, they are all hale and hearty because they are to move 30 days towards and 30 days backwards from the Tabard Inn where they have gathered together to move on their pilgrimage. Why have they chosen to go to the shrine of St. Thomas Becket, who rids people, who rids his pilgrims of physical ailments? And this is something that Geoffrey Chaucer has very purposely brought to light. And I, in the succeeding lectures, in the succeeding description of the pilgrims, will tell you what actually is the ailment that is causing many of the pilgrims to move towards Canterbury. Now, the pilgrims. The word suggests that pilgrims are those people who go with full devout heart to some shrine seeking the help from the saint. And they are the people who should not carry any traces of their status, of their position, of their money. Because money is the thing that should be left behind while you are on a pilgrimage, because it is essential while to procure a spiritual gain, one must leave behind the material possessions. But of the 30 pilgrims that are on their way to Canterbury, we see many of them, and in fact, Chaucer takes every delight to describe them as they have come there, as making a show of their positions. Most of them, their dresses, their status has been explained not just to introduce you to the state that they have emerged from, but to tell you that they are in good state, that all of them love their money and have come to show their best. Isn't it ridiculous to see these pilgrims? But we will see them with all their frivolity, with all their love for money. And they have chosen. You know, it's not that. It is the season wherein offerings should be made to St. Thomas Becket, or where people should go without taking into consideration what actually is the environment, are the hazards that might be lying in their way. But they have chosen the month of April. And Chaucer takes every pleasure to describe every details of the intoxicated April, where vines are intoxicated, where birds are making melody, small fowls are making, foals are making melody, and where there are rich crops growing on both the sides of the road, that these pilgrims can have their full while on their way towards Canterbury. So they have chosen, it appears as Chaucer begins his poem, he begins by telling that the young son had run halfway, half course in ram, and this it is the sign of zodiac, the first sign of zodiac in which the sun has moved halfway through and has entered and has launched, heralded for us the month of April, the month of sheer gaiety. So pilgrims are moving ahead. They have perforce taken this time where they can have all pleasures. Pilgrims in a pleasurable environment. Pilgrims in their rich arrays, dresses. And pilgrims more into external show and less into spiritual gains, leaving apart a few who will be like jewels among this string of beads. The third point in Canterbury Tales that needs to be understood is how Chaucer represents the state and the church. Among the pilgrims are there several, and the leader of which is the knight, who come from the state. There is the miller, the reeve, the wife of Bath, the municipal, and quite many of them who represent, and the guildsmen who represent the state. So it is as if the whole of 14th century England is marching towards Canterbury. Representatives of state have been chosen. and there are representatives of the church led by the monk. The monk who has chosen to serve the world and who has very little study of Bible. So it is an everybody of the state studied in this masterpiece of characters. In those times, 14th century England was, in fact, it had two big institutions. The biggest was the state, politically, and yet another big institution was the church, religiously. So, Chaucer has taken the monk, the prioress, the friar, the clerk of Oxford, and the pardoner and the summoner as representatives of the church, who have their small distortions and large as well. But church shouldn't be put to ridicule absolutely. Therefore, there is the parson traveling much and light on his stuff. So we see all the shades of men as are possible, and Dryden ultimately had to say that here there are God's plenty. So all the plenty kinds of people that God could have created are there in this portrait gallery of the pilgrims. Chaucer perforce doesn't take the royalty, the royal people, because they could not have afforded, due to political instability, this journey of 60 days. And to hold them to ridicule would have been very unwise. Also, he doesn't take the lowest people, because Chaucer would not prick at the conscience. He was a good poet, he was a good human being. He would not prick at the conscience of poor people, because also they would not have managed this journey of 60 days. So theirs is, it's not possible for them. Chaucer has very wisely selected his representatives from state and church, and this could have confounded him if he had not put them in the order of decreasing worth socially as well as on the ecclesiastical society. Therefore, Chaucer, the master, chooses to write down his document, the prologue, and says that I am presenting them in the order of their entry into the Tabard Inn. So he saves his skin and apologizes for a low sight when he says, as it seemed me. So he makes a sketch to be held for a proper scrutiny, how fair they were, how fair they were to stand as pilgrims moving towards Canterbury. So all God's plenty are here. The real good people are there, and the real scoundrels are also there. So the dealing, one other aspect of the prologue to Canterbury Tales is the humor. What is humor? a layman would say that humor is the spirit of laughter. Something that evokes laughter is humor. But humor had two meanings for Chaucer. Humor did not mean just laughing with others, but humor meant the four classes, the four humors as given in homeopathy, that is the hot, cold, moist and dry. And his pilgrims are a combination of these four humors. Humor must also be differentiated from satire, because satire is laughing at others, whereas humor is good nature in a good spirit, laughing with others. So when you are pricking at the conscience of others, you are also pricking at your own. Geoffrey Chaucer is one among the pilgrims. He is not out of them. So he doesn't spare an opportunity to ridicule himself as well. So humor is evoked in the setting of the poem, which is a merry month, a month of complete merriment. There is humor in the portrayal of the characters, because they are caricatures. They are the individuals, and also they are the types. So when we read them, they all have a typical quality, a typical trait that was singular to that class of which his pilgrim is the representative. And there is also humor in the portrayal. When he has to make fun, he sees to it that he begins it in the earnest. He begins by saying that there was a worthy man. And no sooner that you read the word worthy, you are convinced that you will see a man deviated from his status. Now, a very important question arises. There is a prologue, there is an introduction to the pilgrims who are all moving towards Canterbury. But why tails? This is the crux of the matter. The tales are the stories, are the stories of the incidents that these pilgrims witnessed. They were a part of these. So, to tell about someone as a second person would be unjust. It is just that the person himself gives an appraisal of himself in the story that he relates. Also, because the route was a 30 days towards and 30 days backwards from Canterbury, it would have been tedious if they travelled silently. So he makes arrangement, Chaucer makes arrangement for each pilgrim to tell two tales towards and two tales backwards, which we will see are in fact the life-size portrayal of these pilgrims. It is a delightful piece of work that will stand over ages as a great document from the father of English poetry, Geoffrey Chaucer. He can rightly be called the father of English poetry, because he doesn't write in English. He writes down his poems in the dialect, in the local native language, native dialect of speech of the Old England. And when he does this, he does it with such dexterity, with such profundity, that it has come to be understood as Chaucerian language. So this great father of English poetry takes you on a merry journey towards Canterbury. You do not get landed into Canterbury because the presentation, the portrayal of the pilgrims is on in the prologue. You are only shown the life-size portraits of these pilgrims, where you see them as us. You can find these people, they are not limited to the 14th century England. They seem to be representatives of that age, but in fact, they can be found even now. But since this is 14th century England, wherein some kind of corruption, some kind of deterioration in moral values had crept into church. And with this purpose, he has his people who he portrays to be pilgrims. Why pilgrims? Because to portray the church, it was needed that they go on a pilgrimage. However, the environment is that of a picnic. So we'll see the delightful and the merry and the frivolous and the distorted and the scoundrels and the angel person outshining all of them from among the men of religion. The clerk of Oxford from among the scholars, the parson from among the guildsmen, and in fact, this all begins with one of the good men from state, that is the knight, and who is going to head this merry journey, this merry group or gang, we can say, gang of merry men moving towards Canterbury. This is all for today. I hope you will try to see while you are doing the text with me. You are seeing these pilgrims seeking their riddance from their ailment, which of course is not physical, but which is spiritual, of a lesser degree or of the ulterior degree. These pilgrims will be an introduction to us. This extensive presentation, for which Chaucer is rightly called the representative poet, because he will introduce you to the customs, rituals of the state and customs of the church in his own style, that is humor, and through tales, because tales would be a first-hand presentation of these pilgrims. Thank you.